just wondering if that's the same bird that I saw here 2 weeks ago. He was sleeping up there on those spikes, or near the spikes. He didn't look very comfortable. And that is just interesting. Okay, anyway, it's Brother Henry. I'm at Superior Market in Inglewood on Crenshaw, just a hop, skip, and a jump from Imperial Highway, I believe it is. And come out to evangelize. When I was here a couple weeks ago, there was just a lot of liquor and alcohol coming through this place. Even people that worked here buying liquor and stuff. And so I come out to evangelize. I understand there's a lot of drug deals going on. A lot of people asking for money, and some are going in and buying booze with that money. So these people need Jesus here. Praise God. How you doing?
All right.
Hebrews 1:9.
Okay, which is that old or new?
New Testament. You've loved righteousness and hated lawlessness. Therefore, God, your God, will anoint you with the oil of gladness amongst all your companions.
Okay, good.
About the Son of God.
Hold up.
Okay.
But what this says in the back has nothing to do with what you just said.
Yes, it does. Hating lawlessness is hating sin. Hating rebellion. Lawlessness is against God's law.
No. Lawlessness.
Okay, right.
So have you ever... Now, you know this.
You know what the law is.
Hold
right?
up.
Lawless. Less law.
Okay, hold up. Now, we're talking about Old Testament.
No, we're talking about the New Testament.
No.
Hebrews is in the New Testament.
Listen. Okay, you said lawless of God is in the Old Testament.
Okay.
Right. God's law is
right.
In the Old Testament.
Right.
But God said also follow man's law. In the Old Testament, God said follow man's law.
And Jesus said to uphold the law.
Okay, but he said, I come to have life more abundantly.
Yeah,
I didn't come
right.
to change the law.
He fulfilled the law and the prophets.
What he did was sacrifices. He sacrificed his life, homie, for someone that didn't really, for his disciples didn't really trust in him, didn't trust in God. But see, we trust in God.
Right.
Period.
Who's Jesus?
Hold
Jesus up. God?
No.
Jesus ain't God?
No.
Or you're wrong.
How?
You need to go back and read the Gospels again.
He said the word.
Light.
Hold up. He said the word.
With a higher comprehension.
Oh, he said the word became flesh.
Right. Who's the
God,
word? Jesus is the word.
Listen, God's word became flesh.
Right.
It is
the
nothing.
Word. Is Jesus the word?
Are you paying attention? Are you listening? You're not paying attention.
No, you're talking at me, not with me.
Okay. No. No, you're not paying attention. What I'm saying. He said,
well, I don't believe what you're saying.
Hold up.
Jesus
he
is
said,
God.
God said, he said, his word became flesh. He did not say, I became flesh. He said, his word became flesh.
Right. So who's he talking about?
So God has a sacrifice.
Who's he talking about? Elijah, Moses, who's he talking about?
Emmanuel.
Okay, and who's that? Jesus.
No.
Jesus is,
no.
What
no.
does Emmanuel
no.
mean?
No. no.
God is with
no.
us.
Yeah.
His
what
name
is,
shall be
what is, what
Emmanuel.
Is Jesus Christ mean? Antichrist. Because God said, my son.
You're confused. You need to read the Bible.
Hold up. Do you believe in Antichrist? Have you ever heard of Antichrist?
I'm talking to one right now.
Okay, but it says Antichrist.
Yeah.
Jesus Christ, Antichrist, Christ Emmanuel.
God is with us, is Emmanuel. You're confused.
You're confused, homie.
No.
If
okay.
you wasn't confused, well, if you was not confused, you wouldn't be out here with this
so
right now.
Satan is the author of confusion, and you're bringing that.
Who? Who's
Satan,
that?
Satan.
Who's that? God say.
You don't know?
Hold up. And Elijah? No. Elijah, right? He said, Morning star, why have you fallen into the darkness?
He didn't say that to Elijah.
No. Hold up.
He's talking about the devil.
No, I'm talking about the Old Testament.
Well,
that's the Old Testament.
Right.
I might not be pronouncing it right.
Isaiah.
That's an Old Testament.
Yeah, Isaiah's in the Old Testament.
He said, Morning star,
right.
Why have you fallen to the darkness?
Right, so who's the great
Lucifer.
Morning star?
Lucifer, hold up. Lucifer is called the morning star.
Right, because he was a bright light.
still is.
Okay, and Jesus is was described as the great morning star.
God,
you see the sun in comparison with the star in the day. It's a lot greater.
When God changes someone's name, he acknowledges in the book, he never, ever, ever said, my son's name is Jesus Christ. He said, you should call my son Christ Emmanuel. 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 But see, right. See, okay. Yeah, hold up. It's getting twisted. See, now it's Illuminati. The sun, the moon, and at the same time, all over the world, you can see the moon and the sun. You can see when they said the sun, right? Banks off the moon, that's what gives the moon that light.
Right.
You can see it in broad daylight.
Lesser light. Call.
Lesser light, whatever. If it wasn't for the sun, the moon would have a light.
Right?
Okay. Now, did you see the two stars?
I haven't looked at them, no.
Oh, it's Illuminati. This is in order, perfect order with God. I mean, see, people still looking at it, think Christ should have come down here. No, 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 no. Oh, why? You've been at it twice already. God came down here in the Old Testament with Gabriel and Michael. That's when he went to Sodom and Gomorrah. And hold up, Esau fought God, and God said, okay, and you're here. Now your name is Israel. That part.
Right.
Okay, so the New Testament, that's King James. You know he's a pirate, you know, all that.
Hold up.
1611. Hold up. Who is the author of the book?
The author of the book?
Who wrote the book? Whose name is in the book?
Well, they're letters.
Huh?
They're letters.
Who is it? Who is,
there's Gospels.
Okay. Hold up.
There's Gospels.
Who is it?
Like they said, Mark wrote Peter's Gospel.
Hold up. No. I'm talking about personally.
Paul wrote letters.
Hold up.
Timothy wrote letters.
Okay, no.
John wrote letters.
I'm talking about Old Testament. Okay. What is his name, homie? Not Socrates, not. What is it? Who is it? The greatest poet of them all. Hold up. Damn. It's on the tip of my tongue. It begins with a CH. Shakespeare. William Shakespeare. That's who wrote the Bible.
Okay.
Right?
No.
Hold up, thou though, that's William Shakespeare, homie. William Shakespeare, because see, they needed, hold up. They need.
I think they're upset. Hold up.
They ain't upset, homie. Care less. Okay. Oh, my bad. Yeah, no. No, I picked it up. Yeah, all right. Now, you know King James, right? He wrote Dead Sea Scrolls. Now you know this in Hebrew. Now, ain't no, he got the prize king with all that, right? So, it's in Hebrew. So he had to go to William Shakespeare, right? To transform this in he, they, why, it was like a play. That part right there.
All right.
Hold up. The Bible is the greatest story ever told.
Okay.
A story.
Have a great day. Have a great evening. Have a great evening.
I'm illuminated.
He's illuminated by this devil. I'm going to come over here until he disappears.
I'm only VIP bronze.
I'm gonna stand over here until I see him leave and then go back because I wanted to preach. Yeah, he's leaving. Definitely illuminated by Lucifer. Devil comes to kill, steal, and destroy, I tell ya. come out tonight to share God's word. I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ. It is the power of God unto salvation, first for the Jew and then for the Greek. That's everybody else if you're not a Jew. What's that? What do I have? What do you mean, what do I have? Oh, these are like verses against alcohol. Because there's a lot of drinking coming in, a lot of alcohol and liquor coming in and out of this market. Spirit of drunkenness, so I'm coming against it. That's why I'm here. I'm here to preach God's word. Excuse me. God has given me some verses against alcohol, being intoxicated with spirits. There's a lot of drunkenness that's coming in and out of this establishment, out of the Superior Groceries. I'm not talking about the people buying water and eating and doing other things like that. But I see people, or have seen people, asking for money in the parking lots, giving you the idea that they may be hungry and want something to eat, and then you find them going in there and buying booze, liquor, to get drunk. I was here a couple weeks ago, talked to one of the guards after I was appalled at all the beer and liquor that was leaving this place. And he said, not only is there a problem with alcohol in this neighborhood, but there's a problem with drugs in this parking lot. And I'm coming against it and the devil by the blood of Christ. So I'm not saying drinking is a sin, but getting drunk is a sin. And I have a lot of verses to back that up. I'm just going to read through them. And they're descriptions of the verses, and some actually talk about the verses. Genesis 9, 20 through 26, Noah became drunk, the result of immorality and family trouble. We have that today. Genesis 19, 30 through 38, Lot was so drunk he did not know what he was doing. This led to immorality. Leviticus 10, 9 through 11, God commanded priests not to drink so that they could tell the difference between holy and unholy. Numbers 6:3, this is from the Old Testament. The Nazarites were told to eat or drink nothing from the grapevine. Deuteronomy 21:20, a drunken son was stubborn and rebellious. Deuteronomy 29:5 through 6. God gave no grape juice to Israel, nor did they have intoxicating drink in the wilderness. Deuteronomy 32, 33, and if you want to get to know Jesus, he quoted more from Deuteronomy and Psalms. You can get to know Jesus by reading those two books a lot. 32, 33 of Deuteronomy. Intoxicating wine is like the poison of serpents, the cruel venom of asps. For those that are indulging themselves in liquor, getting liquored up, it's evil. You got bad spirits. That's why they call it spirits, wine and spirits. And it compares it to venom of asps. Or adders, serpents, snakes. It's wicked. Judges 13, 4, 7, and 14. Samson was to be a Nazarite for life. His mother was told not to drink wine or strong drink. 1 Samuel 1, 14 through 15, accused, Hannah said she drank no wine. 1 Samuel 25, 32 through 38, a man named Nabal died after a drunken spree. 2 Samuel 11, 13, by getting Uriah drunk, David hoped to cover his sin. More evil, attributed with alcohol. 2 Samuel 13, 28 through 29, Amnon was drunk when he was killed. 1 Kings 16, 8 through 10, the king was drinking himself into drunkenness when he was assassinated. You have a Bible at home, you can, or one in the car, you can follow along. 1 Kings 20, 12 through 21, Ben-Hadad and 32 other kings were drinking when they were attacked and defeated by the Israelites. 1, 5 through 12, the king gave each one all the drink he wanted. The king was intoxicated when he commanded the queen to come. Psalm 75, 8, the Lord's anger is pictured as mixed wine poured out and drunken by the wicked. Now we're going to get into Proverbs about alcohol. Proverbs 4, 17, alcoholic drink is called the wine of violence. Oh, I grew up in a house of drunkenness with my own dad drinking himself stupid. And there was a lot of violence, believe you me. Proverbs 21. Wine is a mocker, and strong drink is raging. Listen up, people. This is all against alcohol. You need to hear this if you're indulging yourself in it, sinning against God. Proverbs 23, 19 through 20. A wise person will not be among the drinkers of alcoholic beverages. Wise person. Proverbs 23, 21. This applies to this parking lot. Let me tell you. Drunkenness causes poverty. How many people are wind up destitute and losing everything and winding up in one of these parking lots begging for money so that they can get more drink? A lot. Oh, and that also then leads to other things, other drugs, which really will ruin a person. Like heroin and crack. Anyways, back to alcohol. Proverbs 23, 29 through 30. Drinking causes woe, sorrow, fighting, babbling, wounds without cause, and red eyes. Proverbs 23, 31. God instructs not to look at intoxicating drinks. Proverbs 23, 32. Alcoholic drinks bite like a serpent and sting like an adder. Proverbs 23, 33. Alcohol causes the drinker to have strange and adulterous thoughts. Strange and adulterous thoughts that lead to willfulness. And prevents reformation. Proverbs 23, 34. Alcohol makes the drinker unstable. Proverbs 23, 35. I should have just read 31 through 35. Alcohol makes the drinker insensitive to pain, so he does not perceive it as a warning. Alcohol is habit forming. It's of the devil. But go ahead, drink yourself stupid tonight. You might wake up in hell. I don't want that for you. Drunkards will not inherit the kingdom of God, according to Paul's letter to the 1 Corinthians. Proverbs 31, 6 through 7. Strong drink could be given to those about to perish. You're not about to perish. Or those in pain. Better anesthetics are available today.
You really coming back?
Who? Who? Jesus? Do you believe he's going to come back? Well, he's going to come back when he's ready. But your judgment day is going to happen when you die. So if you die in your sins, you're going to die, you're going to go to hell.
But, how do I know if I die myself?
Well, you have to repent of your sins. That way, what? No. Saints who are born again have the power over sin. Where does it say it's a sin to judge? No, it's not. Give me the verse, Christian. It says, don't judge hypocritically. Judge not by appearance, but judge righteous judgment. That's what it says. I judge a righteous judgment when I come out here and judge against alcohol and drunkenness. And when I tell you the truth that you're going to die in your sins if you don't believe he is he, you're going to go to hell. Jesus said, unless you repent, you will all likewise perish. That's what Jesus said. So I'm just reiterating what Jesus said. It's the truth. I care enough about you to tell you the truth. What you do with it is on you. So that there's no blood on my hands, but if you neglect this so great a salvation, your own blood's going to be on your head. So repent of your sins and become born again. Now we're going to go to Ecclesiastes 2:3. Solomon wrote that, the richest man of the world. The king tried everything, including intoxicating drink, to see if it satisfied, and it did not. You can also look at Ecclesiastes 12:8. Ecclesiastes 10:17. A land is blessed when its leaders do not drink. Going to the prophet Isaiah 5:11-12. Woe to those who get up early to drink and stay up late at night to get drunk. Oh, I'm talking to somebody. Isaiah 5:22. Woe to the champion drinkers and experts at mixing drinks. I used to be a champion of the bottle, but now I'm an ex-drunk. An ex-drunkard. I've been delivered from drinking and getting drunk. Isaiah 19:14. Drunken men stagger in their vomit. Isaiah 22:12-13. The Israelites choose to drink. Their future looks hopeless to them. Isaiah 24:9. Drinkers cannot escape the consequences when God judges. 28:1 of Isaiah, God pronounces woe on the drunkards of Ephraim. 28:3, proud drunkards shall be trodden down. Isaiah 28:7, priests and prophets stagger and reel from beer and wine, err in vision and stumble in judgment. These are all verses from God's word, trying to edify you, bring you in the light. To the truth about alcohol and its debilitating effects. Trying to wake you up, people. Be sober, be vigilant. Your adversary, the devil, walks about like a roaring lion seeking to devour you. Isaiah 56:9-12. Drinkers seek their own gain and expect tomorrow to be just like today. In Jeremiah 35:2-14, the Rechabites drank no grape juice or intoxicating wine and were blessed. Hear that? Ezekiel 44:21, again, God instructed the priest not to drink. On to Daniel 1:5:17, Daniel refused the king's intoxicating wine and was blessed for it, along with his abstaining friends. You too can abstain from liquor and wine and beer. You don't have to get drunk. Daniel 5, 2 through 3, the king, along with his nobles, wives, and concubines, drank from the goblets which had been taken from God's temple. Daniel 5, 4, drinking wine was combined with praising false gods. When you get drunk, you do things that you normally wouldn't do when you were sober. I got some more verses for you, people. Still in the Old Testament, Daniel 5:23, God sent word to Belshazzar that punishment would be swift for the evil he had committed. On to Hosea 4:11, 4:1:1. Intoxicating wine takes away intelligence. I was talking to a man, I believe he was drunk, had to have been drunk, and there wasn't very much intelligence in him. Hosea 7:5, God reproves princes for drinking alcohol. Why am I talking about alcohol? Because there's a lot of alcohol coming in and out of this store. A lot of cheap booze that people are buying to get drunk, and it's wrong. God says to be sober. Drunkards will not inherit the kingdom of God. 1 Corinthians 9, 6, 9 through 10, excuse me. Right here, Joel 1, 5, drunkards awake to see God's judgment. You're going to lift up your eyes in torment and hell to see that? Oh, I don't want that for you. Joel 3, 3, the enemy is judged for selling girls for wine. Amos 2, 8, unrighteous acts of Israel included the drinking of wine, which had been taken for the payment of fines. Sounds like corrupt judges to me. Amos 2:12, Israel is condemned for forcing Nazarites to drink wine when they're supposed to be abstaining themselves from wine, not to cut their hair either. Micah 2:11, Israelites are eager to follow false teachers who prophesy plenty of intoxicating drinks. Nahum 1:10, the drunkards of Nineveh will be destroyed by God. Habakkuk 2:5, a man is betrayed by wine. Same book, Habakkuk 2:15. Woe to him that gives his neighbor drink. Don't do it. Habakkuk 2:16, drinking leads to shame. Now we're going to go to the New Testament, the New Covenant, the New Blood Covenant of Jesus Christ, with its verses. Matthew 24, 48 through 51. A drinking servant is unprepared for his Lord's return. Unfaithful servant. Luke 1, 15, the Gospel of Luke. John the Baptist drank neither grape juice nor wine. Some of you Christians know that. Luke 12:45, Christ warned against drunkenness. Luke 21:34, drunkenness will cause a person not to be ready for the Lord's return. Now what if he comes tonight? And you got a 40-ouncer of Old Eight in your hands and you're sitting back, lean back in your recliner, getting drunk. It's not going to look good. That's why Christ warned against drunkenness. Right? The unfaithful servant was drinking.
Excuse me, sir. Can I get
that? Oh, sorry. Romans 13:13. Do not walk in drunkenness or immorality. A lot of times the two go hand in hand. Drunkenness and immorality. Romans, Paul's letter to the Romans, 14, 21. Do not do anything that will hurt your testimony as a believer. First Corinthians 5, 11. If a Christian brother is a drinker, do not associate with him. Oh, there's a lot of Christians that get drunk. I see them. I go to clubs, the nightclubs, to tell people about Jesus Christ. And I catch them in line going into clubs drunk. Already drunk before they go into the clubs. Apparently they haven't read their Bible. 1 Corinthians 6:10, drunkards will not inherit the kingdom of God. I have to say this, people, because there's a lot of beer and wine and liquor being sold here. And a lot of people buying it and getting drunk. Even the people that work here are buying liquor to get drunk. So what kind of example is that? Come here, sinner. Let's talk about this. What is sin?
Exactly, what is sin?
Sin is breaking God's law.
That's not breaking God's love, though.
What?
That's not breaking God's love.
Bringing God's love to warning somebody who's going to get drunk tonight to drink is love.
He sees everything we do.
Right.
And don't you say that God forgives everybody?
No, where does it say that?
It says it.
What about the people in hell? Were they forgiven? The people in hell now.
That's their problem.
Well, that could be your problem, too, if you don't repent.
Yeah, well, if I go there, I'll probably see you there, too.
No. You'll see me from hell, but I don't want that for you. I want you to be in heaven with me.
Good job.
Thank you. God bless you. Thank you. Back to the verses again. Don't deny Jesus Christ. If you deny Him, He will deny you before His Father and the holy angels. Don't do it. Galatians 5:21, Acts of the sinful nature. Here we're going to talk about sin so the sinner can hear it. Such as drunkenness will prohibit a person from inheriting the kingdom of God. That is love for me to tell you not to drink. God tells you not to drink. I'm a messenger for Him and I'm telling you not to drink. Don't do it. You won't inherit the kingdom of God. There's a lot of other good things to drink. I'm an ex-drunk. God delivered me from alcohol and cigarettes. And there's good juices to drink. There's good water, alkaline water. There's good herbal teas and things, and a lot of juices and stuff that are good for you, beneficial for your body. Alcohol destroys your body. It destroys your kidneys and it destroys your liver. Alcohol dehydrates your liver. That's why you're thirsty the next day when you're hungover. Because it robs you of the water, the moisture, the nutrients in your body, in your liver and in your kidneys. And it will send you to an early grave where your homie will pour a 40 over your tombstone. Don't do it. I want to compel you not to drink. It's of the devil. Even though it's red in color and sparkles in the glass and swishes around. No, it bites like a serpent and stings like an adder. Ephesians 5:18, in contrast to being drunk with wine, the believer is to be filled with the Holy Spirit. When you're filled with the Holy Spirit, you don't need all the things of the world that will intoxicate you and pollute you. Poison. Alcohol is poison. It will destroy you and send you to hell fire. Time to wake up, people, and understand the truth. And stop playing with your souls. 1 Thessalonians 5, 6 through 7. Christians are to be alert and self-controlled, belonging to the day. Drunkards belong to the night and darkness. Stop your drinking. Pour the beer out. oh, something might happen bad tonight, like you might get into a fist fight and get clocked and then hit your head on the curb and die. You will wind up in hell. Maybe you'll get into an argument with somebody in a bar and somebody will put a knife in you. Oh, won't be good. Maybe you'll go in the wrong neighborhood and talk smack and a gangbanger will shoot you in the head and you'll die in your sins. A drunkard. Don't do it. Here's another one. 1 Timothy 3, 2-3. Bishops, elders, are to be temperate.